In a word, the Lord said, now to keep you from being able to talk about this in some kind of boastful way, we're going to fix this thing for you. I'm going to put a thorn in your flesh. Okay? And so Paul here in the text, as we get into it, is moving to a place where he is accepting his condition. Somebody say, accepting your condition.
Accepting
the circumstances that you find yourself in. Mm-hmm. See, because oftentimes we don't want to be in the stuff that we're in. Am I right about that?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. You know, oftentimes we don't want to be in that stuff we're in. Some of the stuff we're in bring pain to us, right?
Yes.
And
yes.
So we don't want always to be in that place. So here Paul is saying that I don't know whether I was in the flesh or in the spirit, but I went to this place.
Mm-hmm.
Only God knows. That's what he says in the text here. Only God knows. So, my brothers and sisters, we know that Paul had a thorn in the flesh. That's what the text tells us, right? He said, was given unto me a thorn in my flesh. And we don't know what kind of thorn it was. We don't know whether it was something physical. We don't know whether Paul had some kind of debilitating disease. We don't know what it was. All we do know is that Paul had a thorn in the flesh. And I like to say that thorn in the flesh was a handicap. Somebody say handicap.
Handicap.
And so we know that handicaps do what? They limit what we can do. Am I right about that?
Yeah.
If you got handicap, you know, you walking around and you got one leg, you're handicapped because you can't walk like other folks walk. If you got one arm, you can't do things that other people can't do. If you got one eye, you don't see like other folks see. Those are handicaps. Am I right about that? And so Paul had a handicap. It limited what he could do in the ministry. So in understanding that handicap bring you to a place that you don't want to be in, all handicaps are not physical. You got to look at somebody and say, all handicaps are not physical.
See,
some handicaps are mental. And when I say mental, I don't mean that you're crazy now. That ain't what I'm talking about when I say mental handicap. What I mean is that you can be in a situation or a relationship situation,
mm-hmm.
That is debilitating, that brings you down and keep you from being the best that you can be. That is a handicap, and it can trouble you. Am I right about it? You can have mm-hmm. children that you have no control over, and they don't listen to nothing you say and nothing nobody else say. They in and out of jail. They've been to prison one time. They all kinds of stuff. All of these are handicapped because they keep you from being the best that you can be. I don't know about you, but I've had some handicaps in my life that were not physical. They were mental, and I had to be able to what overcome them. And you overcome them not on your own, because if you could overcome them on your own, you wouldn't have the handicap. Am I right about it?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So let us address three questions here in this text. First, I want to say, what are the weaknesses Paul has in mind when he says the power of Christ is made perfect in my weakness? Well, what kind of weakness is he talking about? The second question we want to find an answer to is, what is the source of the weaknesses that Paul is referring to? Do they come from Satan or from God or both? The third question we will find an answer to, is, what is the purpose of such weaknesses? Why do we have these? Is there a goal or aim for these weaknesses that come into our lives? Three times Paul prayed for healing and did not receive it. He received, however, things far greater because he received grace. Somebody say grace.
Grace.
From God. And we'll talk about that a little bit longer, but later. He received a strong character. He received humility and the ability to empathize with other folks. See, some of us don't have no patience with people. Am I right about that?
Mm-hmm.
We don't have no patience with folks. If you're not going my way and doing things my way, then we don't have time for it. I don't have time for it. I want it my way, and if it's not my way, it's got to be the highway. But with God, see, we know that things have to be different. What are the weaknesses Paul had in mind when he quotes Jesus saying in verse number 9, my power is made perfect in weakness, and I will all the more gladly boast in my weaknesses rather than boasting about what God has allowed me to have or see. I see four words in verse number 10, okay, that will help us to understand, I believe, what Paul is saying. Now, four words in verse number 10 that I want us to focus up and look at. Number one is insults, hardships, persecutions, and calamities. You all see that? It's in verse number 10. Insults, when people think of clever ways of making your faith or your lifestyle or your word look stupid or weird or inconsistent. You know what I'm talking about, right? When folks try to insult you by saying funny kind of stuff, you know what I mean? Crazy stuff. You know, insult you. Mm-hmm. Insult your intelligence. I wish I had a witness in here today.
Right.
Hardships. Circumstances forced upon you. Reversals of fortune against your will. I don't know about you, but I know my wife had money in a 401k. And back in the 2000, before 2010, the market started going down, right? And Betty lost about all of the money that she had in her 401k before we decided the market was going to bottom out and she was going to lose everything. So we got that little bit out that she had left.
Mm-hmm.
You know, hardships that we had no control over at all. You didn't plan for it to happen, but it happened anyway. But it was hard for you to take. And it was hard for us to take that. Losing almost everything that we had put in because she'd been working and we put in as much as we could put in there because she had no retirement. So we wanted that to happen. But that was hardship for us. Persecution. Wounds or abuses or pain, circumstances or act of prejudice or exploitation from people because of your Christian faith or your Christian moral commitment. It's when you are not treated fairly. And I don't know about you all, but I've been there too, done that, got my coffee cup and t-shirt. Calamities, distresses, difficulties, and trouble. The idea is one of pressure or crushing or being weighed down, circumstances that tend to overcome you and cause you to be stressed out or have all kinds of headaches. How many of y'all in here wake up sometime, you got headaches and ain't nothing happened to you? You just laid down, went to sleep, and woke up in the morning and you had a headache, huh? And you had a headache because everything, you knew what you had to face during the day and you had no way of knowing how it was going to work out. Anybody ever been there? Yeah. So you can see here and then, what Paul had in mind is not sin. Okay? Paul is not talking about sin here. He's not talking about bad behavior, like you might have a weakness and you can't control yourself, you know, and every time you drive by Bubba's liquor store, you can't drive by without stopping and getting you a little something anyway. You know, he's not talking about that kind of stuff. So Paul is not talking about bad choices we make in life. He not saying the power of Christ is made perfect in my bad choices. Or I will all the more gladly boast by because of my bad choices. See, weaknesses and circumstances and situations and experiences and wounds, he talking about that make you look weak. Things that are happening to you that you don't have no control over that take away yourself from your situation. You know what I'm talking about? Take you away from your situation and cause you to be acting and responding to something that you have no control over.
Mm-hmm.
If we were strong enough, all right, we would fight against this kind of stuff. Am I right about that?
Mm-hmm.
No. If we were strong enough, we would be victorious over all these kind of things. If we were strong, we would take charge of our own future and our own fortune. And we would turn everything around, every hardship. We would turn that stuff into something that would lift us up and help us to be able to stand on top of the world. If we were strong enough, we would turn back persecution. We would not let nothing come into our life that would cause us not to be able to be the best that we could be. If we were strong enough. We wouldn't let these things come into our hands. But in reality, we don't have the kind of human strength, or even if we had it as Christians, we are not supposed to return evil for evil. Am I right about that?
Amen.
The Bible tells if somebody slap you on your left side, turn your right side to them. Let them slap you down. Isn't that what the Bible said? Y'all Christian in here, if there ain't any Christian in here, the Bible said, we don't do evil for evil. All right? If somebody asked you to carry that coat 1 mile, you grab them and hey, what else you got I can carry? And go another mile. That's what the Bible teaches. But see, on the other side of the coin, if you flip the coin the other way, see, if it was in our control, we would not allow nothing to come upon us that would harm us. I wish I had a witness in here today.
All right.
So the answer to our first question is that weaknesses are not sins. All right? Weaknesses are not sins. But experiences and situations and circumstances and wounds that are hard to bear and that we can't remove ourselves because it's beyond our control. These things are brought on us not because we wish them on us, but because God has made it possible for these things to happen to you. Okay? All right. The second question said, where do they come from? Where do these weaknesses come from? What is the source of our fleshly thorns? Do they come from Satan or do they come from God or both? Let's take a look at Paul's thorn in the flesh, okay? In verses 1 through 4, Paul describes what amazing revelations of God's glory was given him, and he was given an opportunity to see. He was caught up into paradise, and he heard things that could not be told on earth. How easy it would have been for him to think highly of himself, all right? Because he had the opportunity to go places and see things that other folks hadn't seen. And we do it right now, don't we? Yeah, you get a chance to go see the Atlanta Falcons play football. You sitting up there in Mercedes-Benz Stadium, you know, with all that stuff going on around you. And you looking at people like me that can't afford the tickets and I can't go. And you got something to talk about. It makes you think that you somebody because you were able to sit there with the big boy in Mercedes-Benz Stadium. But I'm trying to say here, that's what Paul is saying. He said, to keep me humble, to keep me from exalting myself, God put a thorn in my flesh to keep me where I need to be. Because I'm human. I can't help it. You know, if I go to Joseph A. Bacon and buy me 4 or 5 suits and I come back here and they're $800-$900 a piece, I might not tell you what they're called, but I throw my coat open so you can see the label in the suit. You understand what I'm saying? I'm not exalting myself. I'm just letting you know where I'm coming from. Am I right about that? Yeah. Now, this thorn in the flesh, whether it was some physical problem or some relentless enemy, is one of the weaknesses Paul is talking about. We know this because he prays that God would take it away in verse number 8. The Lord answers him in verse number 9. He said, my power is made perfect in your weakness.
Uh-huh.
My power is made perfect in your weakness. See, if you don't have this weakness, you will never get a chance to see my power at work.
Mm-hmm.
See, you got to be able to go through something so you can get to something.
Yeah.
You see, I can stand here today and think about some of the things that happened in my own life and some of your lives too. I can think about these things and I wondered, when it was happening, how am I going to make it through? But the Lord had told me in the word, my power is made perfect in your weaknesses.
Yes.
The thing you can't handle, I already got it handled. As a matter of fact, I had it handled before you got into it.
Mm-hmm.
So the thorn in the flesh is one of the weaknesses that we all have to deal with. And where did it come from? Paul calls it a messenger of Satan, given him to harass him. He said, a messenger of Satan given to him to harass him. So one answer is that some weaknesses come from Satan. Satan afflicts the children of God through his angels and messengers and little imps, right? His aim is to destroy you. The Bible said that Satan come to do what? Kill, steal, and to destroy. That is to bring misery on you and I by any means necessary. Satan's attack on Paul is to produce pride, not to prevent pride. He wants Paul to think highly of himself because he knows that that is in direct opposition of what God wants. See, Satan talks with God. He's in that realm. The whole world is in Satan's hand. We all are in this world. And so Satan, we all in the hand of Satan, but we don't have to abide by what Satan brings to us. God has given us his Holy Spirit to give us power over everything that Satan may bring into our life.
All right.
So you don't have to fall down just because Satan tell you to fall down. You can stand. The Bible says when you've done all you can do to stand, you can keep on standing because there's power in the Word of God. And if you use God's Word, you have power because the Word of God will not fail you. Yeah, so Paul's revelation in paradise made him vulnerable to pride and self-exaltation. So God uses the hostile intent of Satan for Paul's holiness. Y'all didn't get that, did you? He used the hostile intentions of Satan for Paul's holiness. See, God knew what he was doing. He knew he had to have somebody to tell the story. So when he let Paul have an opportunity to see something, and then put Satan in Paul's path, he knew Paul was going to pass the test because he knew what was in Paul. See, God looks at each and every one of us and he puts stuff on us based on what he knows is in us and what he knows we will stand up for. See, some people don't fall for anything, but there are some folk will stand. Mm-hmm. And when they've done all they can do to stand, they'll keep on standing.
Yes.
Another reason we know this is God's work and not Satan is when Paul prays in verse 8. That God would take away the Lord, that God would take away his thorn. The Lord said to Paul, no, because my power is made perfect in weaknesses. I have a purpose, Paul, for what you are going, what's happening in your life. This is not ultimately Satan's destroying work in you. It is ultimately my saving and sanctifying work in you, Paul. God permits Satan to afflict his righteous servant and turn things so he can turn things around, Job. See, Job was a rich man and Job had everything going for himself. But God allowed Satan to affect Satan's body from the top of his head to the bottom of his feet. But in the end, somebody say in the end.
In the end.
When it was all said and done. When there was nothing Satan could do more, God gave Job double for his trouble. And God is looking for somebody right now who will stand up and say, God is still God, still Lord.
Yes.
Yeah, I have a purpose. Other grace for what you're going through. Don't give up. Don't listen to the voices out here in the world. But you stand firm on my word. Because my word tells you, Arthur and Sister Reeves and Brother Elvin and Reverend Thomas, my word tells you that I won't never leave you nor forsake you. I'm going to be with you to the end of the earth.
All right.
Yeah, so we find right here, and we go get a chance to know that God's grace is sufficient. Thank God for grace this morning. Woke me up. Started me on this journey. Don't know where I'm going to be at the end of the day, but the grace of God tells me. I don't have to ask for it. God gave it to me. It was free. It was a gift this morning when I opened my eyes. Somebody say grace.
Yes, grace.
Everybody say grace.
Grace.
It's sufficient. This brings me to the final point here today. What is the purpose of such weaknesses? Is there a goal? We know where they come from. They come from God. And sometimes God allows Satan to afflict us so that he can prove to us that his power is made perfect in our weaknesses.
Mm-hmm.
And then we know that weaknesses that we occur in Christ are not sin, but they are weaknesses that the Lord says to us that I have given you power over. Somebody say over.
Over.
I'm reminded of Psalm number 8, which says that the Lord made man a little lower than the angels, but he crowned him with glory and honor. And then he gave him dominion over everything that God made man had dominion over. So I'm reminded today, as we think about this, what Paul was going through was not because of any sin, but because of God's trust and belief in what he had put in Paul. The power will be able to stand against it. Let me say finally here, what is the purpose of these weaknesses? Is there a goal or aim for which God allows these weaknesses to come upon us? Weaknesses come upon us. Why? And Paul mentioned them in verse number 10. Weaknesses like insults and hardship, persecution, calamities and troubles. Why can I find a good job, a good paying job? Why am I stuck in this emotionally draining situation?
Mm-hmm.
Why are my children the worst children on the block? Can't keep them in school because they're always in trouble. Why is my family going through so much when everybody else seems to be living on a flower bed, the road? Why, God, is this happening to me? And Paul gives three answers about this in his own experiences that I think will help us today. First, he says that Satan has the purpose to buffet or harass you.
Mm.
And so it is okay for you to pray and ask God to remove these things out of your life.
Mm-hmm.
That's what Paul did. And he kept praying until God spoke to him. God does not delight in your suffering. He does not delight in you going through hell. Satan does, and we have to resist him. But God does not want us to go through all these trials and tribulation that oftentimes we go through. And sometimes it's because we don't have enough patience, enough stamina, enough belief in his word to stand on the promises that he's made.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes we give up too soon.
Yeah.
Sometimes we take our hand off the plow when we should keep our hand on the plow.
Yeah.
Sometimes we quit running the race that's before us.
Yeah.
And stop looking to him who's able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we ask him to do. Sometimes we do not go all the way to the end. And so we're not able to reap the benefits of God's word. Secondly, God's purpose over and through Satan's harassment is for our humility. Oh, y'all didn't get that, did you? We rattled somebody here. Yeah, sometimes Satan's harassment is for our humility. Paul was in danger of exalting himself. And so God steps in to keep Paul humble. I heard Denzel say to some people he was talking with, he said, when you go to bed at night, you need to put your shoes way under the bed. So that in the morning when you get up to get your shoes, you got to get on your knees first before you can get to your shoes. So I'm just trying to tell somebody in here today that having a hard time praying, when you go to sleep at night, put your shoes way under the bed. And when you fall down and get your shoes, you can't help but say, thank you, God, for giving me the opportunity to bow down just to get my own shoes. Thank you, God, for giving me some shoes to reach under the bed and pull out from under them. Thank you, God, for giving me the mind to remember where I put my shoes.
All right.
So I'm going to say thank you today.
Thank you.
So Paul was in danger of exalting himself. So God took steps to keep him humble. This is an utterly strange thing in this day and time, because there's not much humility around anywhere. To God, humility is more important than comfort. Somebody better get this.
Mm-hmm.
To God, humility is more important than comfort. Yeah. To God, humility is more important than freedom from the pain that you're going through. Yeah, you ought to be glad to go through something. Because if you're going through it, you know that that's not the end. Like I told us last Sunday, I said, you don't get the victory when you approach the problem. You don't get the victory while you're going through the problem. You get your victory when you get on the other side of your problem. That's when you can shout and say, thank you, God.
Thank you, God.
Yeah, sometime I was down, but you picked me up.
Yes.
Sometime I couldn't move, but you made a way for me.
Yes.
Yeah, thank you, God. Yeah. God will give us mountaintop experiences in paradise. And then he'll bring us down to the lowest level of everything so that he can get us to be humble in that process. Sometimes he'll let us have the world in the palm of our hands. And sometimes he'll take our hands away so we can't hold anything in our hand. But then God still won't leave you because God has a way of making a hand that you always have needed. No, not necessary anymore. And so somebody can say, Lord, I thank you for making a way for me. God, I thank you today for taking me up on the mountain. I thank you for the valleys. And I thank you, Lord, for being able to understand that, yea, though I walk through the valley and the shadow of the dead, I will fear no evil, for I know you're with me.
Yes.
So his purpose is for our humility and loneliness. Mm-hmm. And reliance on him.
Amen.
Finally, God's purpose in our weaknesses is to glorify the grace and power of his son, Jesus Christ.
Mm-hmm.
And this is the main purpose that is pointed out in verses 9 and 10. And Jesus said, my grace is sufficient for you. My power is made perfect in weaknesses. God's design is to make you a showcase for Jesus Christ. Somebody ought to say, thank you, God.
Thank you, God.
For choosing me.
Yes.
But it's not necessary.
Mm-hmm.
Always because of the demands of the world. Sometimes get in our way and cause us to fall prey to the enemy.
Mm-hmm.
But I want to tell somebody today that God has strength that he has given unto each of us in the power of his Holy Spirit.
Yes.
We may not see him right here, but we understand where he is because we sometimes can just feel him moving through our bodies.
Yes.
Can I get a witness in here today?
Yes.
Sometimes the Lord said, as he was talking to Nicodemus, sometimes he liked the wind. You can look at the trees and you can see the leaves shivering and shaking. And you don't see the wind, but you know the wind is there. So we don't always see the Holy Spirit, but we know he's here.
All right.
Somebody ought to say, thank you, God, because he said in his word that when two or three are gathered together, touching and agreeing.